Strathcona horse, who are currently on peacekeeping duties in Cyprus. The medal that these men are receiving is, in reality, an extension of the Nobel Peace Prize. And as such, it is not merely a proof of service, it is also a medal of honor. When I first visited the Canadian peacekeepers in Cyprus soon after their arrival in 1964, no one imagined that this duty would last nearly a quarter of a century. These Canadians, like the thousands who have served before them, have to keep the peace between two warring factions who are separated by a buffer zone which cuts its way across this eastern Mediterranean island, which is about 1.5 times the size of Prince Edward Island. At the center of this twisting trail of barbed wire, sandbags, and gun towers is Sector 3, an area that includes the divided city of Nicosia and a portion of its rural suburbs. Sector 3 is under the protection of the Canadians. In a moment, a return visit to the peacekeepers, 24 years later. One thing that has not changed since my last visit to Cyprus in 1964 is the breathtaking beauty of a sunrise over the Swiss Alps, this time viewed from the cockpit of a Hercules. But back in 1964, it was aboard an RCAF Yukon. But when I landed that August day 24 years ago, the 22nd Regiment had been on duty in Cyprus for only a few months. As a matter of fact, the Canadians were the first of the UN units to arrive. And initially, the Canadians were stationed along the buffer zone in the city of Nicosia. But as I view the film that we shot during that assignment 24 years ago, the film you're looking at right now, I remember a visit to one of their outposts in the Carinia Mountains. They had to be shuttled in by helicopter, and their camp was in a valley located between the Greek and Turkish Cypriots, who would, on occasion, shoot at each other over the heads of the peacekeepers, who could do nothing more than take cover. Then when things quieted down, they would visit the two camps and try to negotiate a ceasefire. It was a frustrating duty for professional soldiers who would have preferred to knock some heads.
It'd be rather like speaking from here to the other side of the world, so we're trying to organize the second down there for a clear line.
And the man who now commands the Canadian forces in Cyprus knows that feeling well. Colonel Chris Wellwood celebrated his 21st birthday in the Carinia Mountains back in 1964, a place he can only look at from afar now because it's a restricted area in the Turkish-held north. But when asked what he remembers most about that duty, he speaks for many who served here in the beginning.
I guess the biggest thing was the frustration of peacekeeping. As a very sort of gung-ho second lieutenant in 1964, I thought that much stronger action should have been taken to make sure that peace was kept on the island, not realizing at the time all the diplomatic niceties that have to be conducted and the very delicate situation that existed at the time.
In 1974, following a Greek military coup, Turkey invaded Cyprus. There was little the peacekeepers could do. However, when the Turks reached the outskirts of Nicosia, the peacekeepers held the line.
This is the international airport just west of downtown Nicosia. Except for a few UN helicopter flights, it's not used anymore, as it's located in the buffer zone. However, on July the 23rd, 1974, this airport was the site of one of the most courageous chapters in Canadian peacekeeping history.
Members of the logistics company took up defensive positions around the airport. They refused to budge, and the Turks decided to quit their advance. Today, all around the airport, there are reminders of that struggle, including a school that was hit by a 500-pound bomb that failed to explode. And so Turkey set up a separate territory. The UN peacekeepers took up their new positions along the so-called Green Line, which they still patrol today. And I found that for many of them, even though they are better prepared psychologically, like their comrades 24 years ago, this duty can be one of frustration that stretches between utter boredom and gut-wrenching anxiety. It is a duty that must be handled by a special type of professional soldier.
They say peacekeeping is not a job for soldiers, but only soldiers can do the job. You don't get any training during your recruit training or your basic officer training for peacekeeping. The lower levels, I don't think, fully realize, especially when you're young and keen and eager, exactly the required amount of diplomacy that's required at the higher levels to ensure that situations don't erupt into something that's uncontrollable.
The Green Line snakes its way across this country through mountains and farmland and city streets, and this is about as narrow as it gets here in Nicosia. The Turks on this side, the Greeks on the other. And by the way, take a note of the black dots on the side of the building here. This means that this particular building is booby-trapped. There have been four killings here along the Green Line since May. Two Greek National Guardsmen, a Turk soldier, and a Turk civilian. And the two sides continually verbally taunt each other. But what is of concern to the Canadian peacekeepers is the fact that this saber rattling has, for some unexplained reason, increased over the past 2 weeks.
Watching TV.
When asked to describe peacekeeping duty, one soldier noted that it was either a case of complete boredom or heart-pounding anxiety. Then, as if to prove the point, while we were visiting the Canadian headquarters in Nicosia, 8 shots rang out. We ran to the street to look down the road to the Greek and Turkish positions that faced each other less than 100 meters away. And the peacekeepers' worst fears were soon to be realized.
Call an ambulance, sir!
Call an ambulance.
Call it, Warren.
Call an ambulance.
Just going to call an ambulance, please.
A Turkish soldier had been shot by a Greek National Guardsman. Now, given the past history of such incidents, this situation could erupt at any moment into a bloody firefight between the two Cypriot camps.
John, crank up the SEALs reserve down here immediately. Warren,
sir.
Have a first aid kit and a vehicle. Take Pasco Richmond back down to the point of the shooting.
Sir. Did you tell you we're hot from here?
People are flinching down there now. So just try and keep it out of the sight as much as possible. If you hear one bang, you're going to have to back up and get in a building.
He was at 3-2-2-2-9-3-1-1. No, no, 9-3-1-1. That's correct. And he was shot in that area. And he fell exactly where he was shot. Yeah, that is part of the buffer zone.
Greek National Guardsmen rushed to their barricades, but this soldier was stopped and was not allowed to proceed until he surrendered his cartridge clip because it would have changed the ammunition allowance at each position. The Canadian peacekeepers move into position, placing themselves between the two Cypriot forces.
He was across the buffer zone, you know, on Borentan Road, where we have the center of the line. They stayed to the north. Where he fell was very close to the overgrown bush that's there, so he was clearly across the ceasefire line, south of it, into the buffer zone. We've evacuated him. He's gone to the hospital. We have launched an investigation now. We're going to increase vigilance all along the line right up to Charlie 4-5.
As it turned out, the Turk soldier, Hassan Kara, died the next day as a result of his wounds. But the peacekeepers were able to calm the situation. What could have been a violent and bloody episode was kept under control by the peacekeepers. However, while the guns were being aimed and a life taken, it was a normal day in Nicosia, the usual traffic tie-up, shoppers like shoppers everywhere trying to decide how much they could stretch the family budget. High school soccer competition was as keen as ever, and children enjoyed the company of grandparents at the neighborhood playground. But for the Canadian peacekeepers, another potential crisis was developing. Guardsmen, the immediate action taken by the Canadian peacekeepers prevented this extremely tense situation from exploding into a violent confrontation.
Bang, and he's fired another shot, and he's been possibly hit just outside the gate. And then the blokes run back to his OP.
Now the United Nations civilian police, they're made up of Australians and Swedes, must conduct an investigation. It's not an easy task receiving the cooperation needed from the two Cypriot groups. Even when UN police dispatched a helicopter like this one to take their photographer up for an aerial view of the shooting site, both the Greek and Turkish officials had to be notified. And usually the flight is taken under protest by one side or the other. It's just another example of the diplomatic wrangling that is part of a peacekeeper's job. And so delicate is the situation that the Canadians decided to cancel a variety show that night in order not to offend the Turks. NCOM show played to a packed house the next night, and an extra matinee performance was arranged to make up for the first night cancellation. This Canadian entertainment unit tours all Canadian bases overseas twice a year, so that means that all the peacekeepers enjoy a little bit of home during their six-month tour. This is the Canadian Command Center of Sector 3 of the UN Zone of Responsibility along the Green Line. Covers the city of Nicosia and portions of the rural outskirts. For the peacekeepers here in the past few weeks, for some unexplained reason, they've been faced with a growing number of violent public demonstrations. And this has put a draining effect on the regiment because they are just not structured to handle this problem of crowd control. But this is where discipline and professionalism come into play. Because as potentially dangerous as it may be and unpleasant, they accept the challenge of crowd control as part of their duty of maintaining the peace. As we witnessed the other day when a report came in from one of the outposts that a demonstration was forming up.
We're now deploying troops down into along a pre-erected barrier that we have in the area to stop them from entering into the buffer zone. One of the mandates of the United Nations is that we are responsible for the security of the buffer zone.
The Canadians racing to the protest site still have vivid memories of a demonstration they handled a few weeks ago, during which several of the peacekeepers were injured.
It is difficult because the Canadian soldier who comes to Cyprus believes, rightly so, that he's here to keep the two sides apart so that the diplomatic solution can be found to the Cyprus problem. And he's a little concerned when one of the sides attacks him physically. He just, I think, has a little difficulty in understanding why he is all of a sudden the enemy.
You can picture from that wall to that wall over there, just solid people and about 20 people back, and they were all just trying to get through any way they could, and it was our job to hold them back. And you really got a feel of what a crowd can do if it wants to put its weight behind something.
Every day there's, you never know what's going to happen. Sometimes it's hectic, you're working straight through the night, and other times there'll be nothing happening for weeks. It seems to go sort of in waves, up and down, here and there. Come here on the island, you get a bit nervous seeing all these weapons back and forth, having them pointed at you occasionally. To put it plain, you could, if they wanted to use it, they could use it at any time. You don't have much of a chance that way. But basically, they understand, since we're allies of both sides, and we're acting as UN soldiers rather than Canadian soldiers here, in particular, they understand that we're here to stop them, both sides, to talk to both sides, to make sure the level of conflict doesn't rise hostilities.
United Nations Command has told Cypriot leaders that they will not be a punching bag, that they have to use more control over these public gatherings. Fortunately, in this case, the quick action by the peacekeepers dulled the enthusiasm of the protesters, and the demonstration never materialized. The peacekeepers are always kept busy mediating disputes between Greek and Turkish farmers. One might see an area claimed by the other, or some sheep may wander across the opposing line. And although such cases might seem to be of minor importance, they can in fact develop quickly into a major and sometimes violent incident.
They're doing quite a lot of planting at the moment, and each farmer gets out there. You've probably seen quite a few cultivators out at the moment, and they try and get every inch of land they possibly can. One farmer may sort of cultivate a couple of feet here and a couple of feet there, some even more than that. And then a week or so later, the National Guard farmer, using him as an example only, would come along and say, well, hang on, he's in fact done my part of the land. Therefore, United Nations have got to deal with a farmer that rightly owns the ground, but his next door mate, sort of mucker on the other side, has had to, or has already planted the ground, and the seed is already in. So a verbal protest will come in, and it usually comes to me as operations officer for a rural squadron. And I go out and get one of my troop leaders to try and sort it out at a lower level. If he can't achieve this by sorting out the problem on the ground, I therefore meet with my equivalent half operations officer or a company commander from the Turkish forces or National Guard forces, depending which, and I try and thrash the problem out there. I therefore have to make a decision before I go there as to what I think should happen, given the circumstances. And therefore, if we don't deal with it there and then, get it sorted out, it will escalate. And before we know that, we have a real fight on our hands. Both forces realise that our presence here is a must. And funnily enough, I was only talking to both sides the other day and asking them this very question. And they appreciate that. that United Nations are here to sort out any particular problem. And we find any problem developing from the mixing up of herds of sheep or whatever, they will come to United Nations for help.
And that's the peacekeeper's main responsibility, to prevent any action that may result in conflict. And it's not always an easy task. Hatred runs deep between the two opposing sides. Nicosia is the Berlin of the Mediterranean. It's a divided city in a divided country. However, as you can see, there is no wall, just a buffer zone that they call the Green Line that separates the two opposing forces. There is another big difference, though. This is the deadlier place, because in Berlin, you can aim a camera over the wall to take a picture of those who man the guard towers on the other side. However, here in Cyprus, we are continually warned that just the pointing of a camera could provoke a serious incident, certainly a protest, perhaps even a bullet.
I can't leave you to take a picture because you will die for the road down. No one can take photos.
And one can make another comparison to the divided city of Berlin. In the Greek south, like West Berlin, the economy is vibrant, construction is booming, consumer goods readily available. However, when you cross to the Turkish north, it is like East Berlin when their wall had been up for just 14 years. The place lacks color, enthusiasm. Consumer goods are scarce. This master tailor is an example that once had a Greek partner, now must have his customers bring their own cloth from the other side. The Greek Cypriots are working hard to promote tourism, and the country is a favorite holiday spot, especially for Scandinavians. Now, at this time of the year, with temperatures hovering around 20 Celsius, at least during the day, you can pick yourself up some good holiday bargains. And one tourist we talked to, Brian McCauley from Scotland, says that the country's political situation was of little concern when he made his plans, and he said that his hosts have been most hospitable.
Where we come from, as I told you, Scotland, we're supposed to be noted for hospitality, but oh boy, this people beat it all.
Along the resort coast, condominium construction is booming, and a number of new major hotels have been built during the past several years. But there is also an oasis of hope on the island. This is the village of Pila, where Turks and Greeks live side by side, and many of them are close friends.
There's no, like, politics, you know, all the people are the same. Lives together, you know, work together, no problem. But he is different. Turkish.
He's
a Greek.
I'm a Greek.
He's a Greek.
Are you? Yeah. I'm a Greek. We're together, no problem with that at all.
My friend.
I mean, in this village, no trouble at all. We live here, I born in this village, and I grow together with the Turkish people, no trouble at all, never. We live in peace.
However, for the majority on both sides here in Cyprus, feelings run deep. As the peace talks continue under the auspices of the United Nations, it is this mutual mistrust that may prevent a settlement from being reached by the June deadline.
We had already 19 meetings between the two leaders. Meetings that take place in my house without witnesses. So they are, let's say, a bit intimate. And I can say that they are able to deal with difficult matters in a business-like manner. I would say, I would add a very important problem. In this kind of intercommunal talks, you usually start from a point in which hatred is the feeling. Now, this is not the case in Cyprus. There is mistrust, of course. There is lack of confidence. There is lack of understanding of the position of the other side. But there is no hatred, which is very important as a basis for a construction. I think that after 25 years, people like Canada that have made such an important contribution has right to ask if they should be taken for granted. And this is a question that I always present to my Cypriot friends. You should not take for granted the United Nations and the countries that are cooperating with you, keeping peace. Anyway, still it is necessary to be a bit more patient, and then I think that the cooperation of Canada will stretch for a time.
As you tour the Green Line, and as you take notes at the military briefings, and you listen to the arguments and the propaganda of both Cypriot zones, and despite the political negotiations currently taking place,
It is difficult to imagine this island ever becoming one country again. And you also have to agree with Lieutenant Colonel Robert Mitchell, who served here in 85 when he said, and I'm quoting now, "Seeing what the Greek and Turkish Cypriots did to their beautiful island in the Mediterranean makes one all the more aware and grateful for the peace and stability that we enjoy in Canada."
I'm very proud of the Canadian soldier over here. He's doing a superb job. The self-discipline that's instilled during basic training is very evident. The force commander, Major General Grindel, has commended the Canadian contingent twice in the last 3 months on their handling of sometimes dangerous and very delicate situations.
And we have to make sure that we maintain impartiality. We have to maintain the fact that we cannot become friends with either side, even though we are allied, because we are UN soldiers, not Canadian soldiers. And it is difficult at times, especially when you have young soldiers. My soldiers on the line that are 18, 19 years old, and someone in the same situation on the other side. But if you get too friendly, then you can't do your job properly here.
And further, over the years,
while covering our Canadian peacekeepers on various occasions, I have come to appreciate and admire the patience, the ingenuity, and the courage that they display day after day while carrying out their duties. How proud they can make one feel to be a Canadian as they maintain the peace. And in that regard, I remember a comment made to me by the commander of the Canadian peacekeeping unit on the Iran-Iraq border.
Well, I spent 34 years of my life training to go to war. And frankly, with all the study and the training I've had, I would much prefer to be doing something like this, because the UN has lost a total of some 700 plus soldiers in 40 years of peacekeeping. That's a day's casualties in some of the battles I've seen. I'd a lot rather prevent war than fight one.
We're growing bush that's there, so he's clearly across the ceasefire line, south of it, into the buffer zone. We've evacuated him. He's gone to the hospital. We have launched an investigation now. We're going to increase vigilance all along the line right up to Charlie 4-5.
John, crank up the CO reserve down here immediately. Warren, have a first aid kit and a vehicle. Take Pasco Richmond back down to the point of the shooting.
All right, we need you to pull back. People are flinching down there now. So just try and keep it out of the sight as much as possible. If you hear one bang, you're going to have to back up and get in a building.
As it turned out, the Turk soldier, Hassan Kara, died the next day.